Welcome to this continuation of Easter worship here on the fourth Sunday of Easter, May 3rd, 2020. I am Peter Marty, and I'm delighted that you are sharing this experience of prayer, scripture, and song with us. A warmest welcome to those viewers who are at a distance or who may belong to another faith community. We are in this together in these online worship days. We are making a special effort at St. Paul, not only to continue to sustain the beautiful forms of community that we appreciate and take to heart, but we're also creating new forms of community through, of course, so many online experiences that are essential to bonding ourselves one to another. The other evening, I heard that 30 adult sponsors, these are confirmation leaders of our 7th and 8th grade boys and girls, they got together on a Zoom conference call, had a delightful time talking about ways in which they are each nurturing their small groups of these 7th and 8th grade students. We've had a number of deaths in this congregation, notifications of which will be listed in forthcoming Journey magazines of the church. But for one recent widow, she was heartened to have some neighbors, including a family from this church, go to clean out her garden beds. What better way to try to adjust to the new realities of life without a spouse as springtime comes and the gifted willingness of others to clean up one's gardens? Beautiful, beautiful. There are all kinds of wonderful signs of generosity by all of you doing your part to make God's kingdom here on earth evolve, whether it's creative uses of stimulus checks or sewing machines. I talked to a woman the other day who has now crafted more than 700 of these face masks, and there's so many of those people in this community of faith. Whether it's your pocketbook, whether it's your postage stamps that you're using to mail things to other people, these are heartening expressions of generosity. It is why we are in the world. So thank you for your offerings, your pledge commitments, your tithes, your special gifts. They're valuable to the ministry here, and believe me, we are putting them to work. Don't forget the dial-in devotion, which is available to you every weekday here at St. Paul, if you'll simply call 563-323-5489 and press 4 when you hear the recording. You will receive a several-minute devotion and a thought for your spiritual life on that day. You know, every week as we leave St. Paul Lutheran Church, we have this little printed statement in our bulletin, which reads, as you leave, please pray for this St. Paul community of faith, that we might be a living example of God's love in this central city and beyond. I pray that some expression of your life this week can further that prayer. And now let's turn to a familiar song of praise to many of you. All creatures worship God Most High.
Creatures worship God Most High. Sound every voice in earth and sky.
Let us speak these words together. Lord, you come to us with open ears, ready to hear us.
So we speak to you with confidence, especially when we are afraid.
Though we cannot see every turn in the road ahead, and our steps are unsure,
we know that you are with us, bearing gifts of life and peace.
We taste and see your goodness as we brighten in your light.
Teach us to open our hands to receive all that you have for us and to share what we can with joy.
The life you offer never runs out. With you, there is always more.
When our hearts grow weary and it feels like we have nothing left, surprise us.
Alleluia, we say. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Let us pray this prayer together.
O God,
we rest today in the comfort of trusting that you know your sheep by name, and you lead us safely through the shadows of death.
Guide us by your voice. Give us the assurance that we are your concern, your joy, and your desire for bringing about the kingdom here on earth. Inspire us to follow this Son of yours, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our reading for this day is from John's Gospel account, the 10th chapter, where Jesus speaks of himself as the Good Shepherd. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hears his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. And as we say in the church, the gospel of the Lord, praise to you, O Christ. Perhaps you've noticed that we Americans have something to say about practically everything. We are very talkative people. And probably more than at any other time in human history, we have more outlets with which to express ourselves, and we use them quite freely. One might think that because God gave us two ears and one mouth, that we would use these devices in ratio, as in 2 to 1. But we do a lot more speaking, and we put a lot more energy into talking than we do into listening. I rather think that many of us think listening is boring and talking is more fun. Yeah, we think of talking as being active or dominant, and we think of listening as being passive or deferential. By and large, we're pretty poor listeners. Many of us don't have this capacity for what I would call deep listening. You know, this open-hearted kind of receptivity to others. Now, if it's true that we Americans have something to say about practically everything, I think we could say the same thing about we Christians. Ever since our religion had its beginning, we have been eager to declare our beliefs. We announce them, we trumpet them, and in a favorite word of the church, we proclaim our beliefs. We tell them to God and to other people. I thought of this the other night when, once again, Franklin Graham, the controversial but fairly notable evangelical leader, buys these 30-second commercial pieces of airtime right around the evening news during these coronavirus times. And Franklin Graham says to viewers, this is what I want you to say right now. You just pray, God, I am a sinner. I believe Jesus Christ is your Son, and I am willing to trust Jesus Christ as my Savior and invite him into my heart. And the prayer goes on, and there's, of course, a phone number there for you to call. And Franklin Graham says, this is what I want you to say or speak right now. Christian people are pretty good about talking. As for our Jewish brothers and sisters, they tend to think of faith much more in terms of listening than of speaking. Much more emphasis on the ears than, in fact, on the mouth. You can tell this by the ways that we pray. In Christian churches, we often conclude our prayers of the community, those petitions, with the words, Lord, hear our prayer, as if it's God's responsibility or assignment or duty to listen to us. Whereas in the Jewish community, the most famous prayer would be the Shema, Hear, O Israel. The responsibility for hearing falls on the ears of the Jewish people, the believers. We're just not very good at listening, to be perfectly honest. We listen with half of an ear sometimes. And if we have two ears and we divide one in half, I suppose mathematically that means we're using only a quarter of our listening skills. But we listen so inattentively and we listen so impatiently that we sometimes speak of listening with half an ear. There's a story from the time of Franklin Delano Roosevelt's second term when he was evidently attending this big gala event, a big noisy ballroom somewhere in Washington, D.C. And as is customary, was customary then, customary now, the president, of course, would greet all kinds of people. Well, it evidently got wearying for Roosevelt to just keep shaking hands, and the small talk of a receiving line got to him. So he decided to do something a little bit interesting. He decided to say with a slightly quieter voice, I murdered my grandmother this morning. And to everybody who would come through the line, eager to introduce themselves, eager to be known, eager to speak to the President of the United States, they'd hear that line and they'd say, wonderful, lovely, keep up the good work, Mr. President. Well, somewhere along the line, a Bolivian diplomat walked through, and diplomats are supposed to be good listeners. And when Franklin Roosevelt said, I murdered my grandmother this morning, the diplomat said to him, well, Mr. President, I'm sure she had it coming. FDR had a sense of humor, to be sure. But even if the story has morphed over time and taken on different strains of exaggeration, as I suspect it may have, it still makes a pretty essential point. We're not very good at listening. Today, I want to direct your hearts not only to one verse in the 10th chapter of John's Gospel, where Jesus says, you know, my sheep, they hear my voice, they recognize it, and they follow me. But I also want to introduce you to a really profound thought of the late Howard Thurman. And Howard Thurman was an African-American theologian in the 20th century. He was an educator. Some people would describe him as a mystic. He was a college chaplain in Boston in the early 1950s. He started a really significant interracial church in San Francisco. At least for its time, it was significant. Howard Thurman was a friend of Martin Luther King Sr. And he was also a significant mentor for Martin Luther King Jr., who often had his papers, Thurman's papers or books, along with him. And Thurman influenced many of the great, more public civil rights figures, particularly around the subject of nonviolence. Thurman studied for a time under Mahatma Gandhi in India. Well, what Thurman said one time is that the most foundational need of every human being is that every person wants to be cared for. They want to be the object of someone else's concern. And they want to be able to relax in the assurance that their life is being heard, that they're being listened to. We all know the pain of not being heard. It hurts. It diminishes us. It lowers our self-worth. When someone is not listening to you, you don't want to spend a whole lot of time around that person. Yeah, you would just as soon park them because they have parked you and made you feel almost null and void. Howard Thurman, the most foundational human need, the greatest longing or the desire of a person is to be cared for, to be the object of someone else's concern, and to be able to relax in the assurance that your life is being heard, that you are being, in fact, listened to. Now, in this 10th chapter of John's Gospel, Jesus speaks with kind of a figure of speech of himself as the good shepherd. And he says, you know, his own sheep are those who hear his voice, they recognize it, and they end up following him. They don't recognize the voice of strangers, Jesus says, so they don't follow strangers, but when they recognize my voice, they, in fact, follow me. It's a really lovely verse, if you think about it. Jesus is so attuned to the people of his pasture, to borrow that lovely phrase and sort of mixed metaphor from the Psalms. Jesus is so deeply attuned to the people of his pasture. He is so attentive to our circumstances and our wants, our worries, our anxieties, our concerns, that he is the kind of shepherd who understands that our greatest need is to be cared for. It is to be of someone else's concern, the object of that. It is, in fact, to be able to relax in the security of knowing that our lives, our voices, ourselves are heard. Now, if you are in tune with this voice of Christ, because you have listened to all of the power of God's word in Holy Scripture, you will not have any trouble recognizing that voice for the most part. You won't have problem distinguishing that voice from all of the noise that clogs up our ears. We will know what God expects of us, and we will know what God wants of us. Jesus says, my sheep, they hear my voice, they recognize it, and so, in fact, they follow me. We will never hear that voice if we believe we always have something important to say, or if we just want to live in our own echo chambers and sort of confirm our biases. We will never hear or recognize that voice of the Lord if there are too many other pretend or erroneous voices clogging up our ears. We will never hear that voice if we believe or we confuse the voice of our Lord with our favorite cable news network. Now, you may be wondering, how do I hear that voice? How do I know what is the voice of the Lord? How can I distinguish that voice from counterfeit shepherds, from spurious shepherds, from make-believe shepherds, from inauthentic voices? How do I know when God is nudging me? Well, that's a great question because, of course, we always have to decide what voice are we going to listen to in so many decisions and pathways of our days. Do I listen to this governor or do I listen to that governor? This one in my state, that one in that neighboring state, as to when I can actually relax socially, publicly, and have some of the life I knew return. Which voice do we listen to when it comes to adequate personal protective equipment and sufficient test kits for this COVID-19? Do we listen to the government health officials? Do we listen to the ICU nurse or ER doc at the local hospital? Who do we listen to when it comes to these things? Young people right now, as in high school seniors and college students, they're all wondering in this time of great upheaval, what voice do I listen to? I'm kind of lost right now. Do I listen to my mom? Do I listen to that teacher or coach who suggested I do this? What do I do about the summer job? I've got this inner voice that's full of all kinds of doubt and worry. Which voice do I listen to? You know, I think also of emergency room physicians and ICU nurses and hospital administrators who these weeks are bearing the almost intolerable burden of deciding who gets potentially life-saving treatment and who doesn't. Which voice do you listen to? If there are a limited number of ventilators, do you give the ventilator to the one who most needs it at this particular moment in time? Or do you listen to another voice that says, no, we should assign that ventilator to the one who has the greatest chance of recovery, even if that should mean denying life to all kinds of marvelous people because of their age, or denying life to them because of their health status? You know, the only way to recognize, really, the voice of God and the voice of our Lord Jesus Christ is to so steep our lives in Holy Scripture, consistently, thoroughly, that we will know when there comes to be a crisis that bears down on our lives, or when there's a trauma that just stares you in the face, that we will know what the will or the way of God most likely is for that particular moment. We will be able to recognize the voice of God. In Mark's gospel, Jesus says, you know, you have ears, and since you have ears, you ought to use them and listen with them. And because you have the capacity to listen, you ought to pay attention to the fact that I know you and that I know what you mean. And if you'll use your ears in these ways, and if you know what you mean to me, you will follow me. Jesus says in this figure of speech of the 10th chapter of John's gospel, my sheep, they hear my voice, they recognize it, and they follow me. Back to Howard Thurman for a moment here. Howard Thurman grew up in an all-black neighborhood of Daytona Beach, Florida. This was in the early 20th century. And one day as a child, he sees a commotion down at the end of the street. People are gathering there, a crowd of sorts, so he runs down the street to see what's happening as even more people are approaching. As it turns out, everybody's attention is focused on this one man, a man by the name of Kentian Butler. He's the town barber. And he's walking circles around this oak tree. He's carrying a large axe in his hand, and every time he circles the oak tree, he chops at the tree as he calls out someone's name, different names. The sheriff of the town is there. He's waiting to take Kentian to the jail, which is really just a stopping point on the way to the mental hospital, or what in those days they would have called the asylum. But because this Mr. Butler is carrying an axe, he's obviously confused and tortured in his mind. And so the sheriff has to hold off, and just, it's kind of a waiting game. Well, somebody hits up on the idea that we need Ma Walker here, sort of the community matriarch. And they send Howard Thurman running for Ma Walker. He goes to her house. And this is a woman who, by the way, says Howard Thurman, she had two distinguishing gifts. Number one, she cared for any and everybody of all different kinds of circumstances. And number two, says Thurman, she had this beautiful rose garden that she had dedicated to God. And that rose garden was actually the supply chain for the altar flowers there at their church. Well, Howard Thurman goes to fetch Ma Walker. He tells her the story. She follows him back down to the end of the street. And as she's approaching the crowd of people and this man with the tortured mind, she calls out his name. She says, Kentian. And he hesitates in his step just a little bit, but he keeps on walking. And she moves much closer into the circle, whereupon the sheriff pulls the gun out of his holster, and the crowd backs up and moves to one side. And Ma Walker, she steps into the circle where Kentian Butler has been walking around this tree, And she keeps repeating his name until finally their eyes meet. And when they meet, she says to him, in the most simple and straightforward of ways, "Come, Kenshin, you must come home with me." He puts down his axe. He listens to her voice, and he follows her home. Now, here's a woman of great personality who understood that the deepest human need, the greatest human longing we have, is to be cared for. It is to be the object of someone else's concern. It is to be able to relax in the assurance or the security that, in fact, our lives are heard, that our voices listen to. "Come, Kenshin, you must come home with me." You and I know the pain of not being heard. It can almost feel sometimes like we don't exist. And it hurts a lot. But what I envision for a really rich life of faith is that somehow we can cultivate the capacity to grow our deep listening skills, that we will take to heart the significance of what it means to listen very receptively, in the most open-hearted of ways, to other people. And the more we can do that, the greater the likelihood, I think, that we will hear the voice of God when God calls us out of the tortured circles of our worst moments, and when God leads us into what Jesus calls abundant life. "Come, Kenshin, you must come home with me now." "My sheep hear my voice," says Jesus, "and I know them, and they follow me." Amen.
If you've been walking the same old roads for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, hear the same old lies, trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, save it. He's a prison shaker. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. But there's a better life. Somebody testify. If you be- feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains,
together, let us confess the faith of the church. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hey girls and boys, Pastor Katy and I were just getting ready to start the children's message. If you're not already there, why don't you come closer to the screen? Yeah, there you go. That's it. Oh, hey Andy, how's it going?
It's been a really hard week. I just feel like there's no one here, and I miss talking to people and hearing their voices, and I just feel really lonely.
I get that, Andy. It's been really hard. It has.
I have an idea. What if we made some phone calls and we called people and could hear a familiar voice, and maybe that would help us feel better and could cheer some other people up too?
Girls and boys, what do you think? I think that might work. We might as well try it.
Yeah. I love that idea.
Who is it? Kinda, yeah, sort of.
Yeah, maybe. Who do you think it is?
Pastor Hayden?
I'll give you a hint. I normally see you on Sunday mornings.
Pastor Hayden, maybe?
Yeah, it is Pastor Hayden. I can't believe you got that so fast.
Do you know who this is? Can you tell who this is? It's okay if you don't. How about I'll give you a hint? I really miss seeing you, especially on Sunday mornings. Does that help you think about who it might be? I especially miss seeing you up front during kids' message time.
Pastor Katy?
You got it! That's awesome! Great job, Dennis.
Hi, who is this that's talking to me?
Ella?
Ella,
it's not good enough
for
you. Something over
to me.
Do
you recognize my voice?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Do you recognize my voice?
Yes. Yes. I recognize it.
I
recognize it?
Yeah, I'm listening to you at church. Do you know who this is?
Yeah.
Who is it?
It's Andy.
Yeah, it's Andy.
I just didn't know what to say.
Wow, I cannot believe that they could recognize our voices. That was so cool. And what a treat, too, to be able to hear their voices and talk to us.
Yeah, it was so meaningful to hear their voices and actually, when I was making those phone calls, it reminded me a little bit of our Bible story for today that we're talking about.
Yeah?
Yeah. You know, Jesus was talking to his disciples about sheep and shepherds. Girls and boys, do you know what a shepherd is? They're the ones who lead the sheep around in the fields. And he talked about how God is like the shepherd, and all the sheep, that's God's people, each of us. And it's like the sheep know the shepherd's voice. They can recognize the voice of the shepherd.
Just like we can recognize each other's voices.
Exactly. Yeah, in fact, we don't necessarily hear God's voice all around us, but we can hear each other's voice just like when we make a phone call. So when we call other people or talk to each other, it's almost like we could be the voice of God sharing the love of God with other people.
Wow. You know, I never thought about it like that. Do you two think that the girls and boys could be that familiar voice to other people right now?
Oh, absolutely. And more than that, they could pick up the phone and call somebody too. That could be an amazing way that you could serve one another and let them know that God loves them.
Yeah, one of the ways we get to share that love of God is by sharing the peace. So if you're with other people right now, stand up, give them a high five or a hug, show some peace and love with others. And wherever you are, whoever you are, know that we're sharing a sign of peace with you. So, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
When we say our prayers as a community, we not only speak words to the Lord, but we also seek to open our ears that we might hear a word from the Lord. So let us pray.
We pray for sensitive ears, Lord, that in the rush of life we would pay attention to really small sounds, that in waking up in the morning we would find our way to some window or porch or sidewalk where we could hear some bird singing, whistling in the wind, or give us a sensitivity to hear small voices, weak voices, crushed voices, or forgotten voices. Lord, we lift this prayer to you.
We pray for discerning ears, ears capable of weeding out the junk in life, the noise of pretend shepherds, the clamor of partisan shouting, and the conspiracy claims that deserve zero attention from all of us. Grant unto us a wise kind of hearing, that we would listen intently for your voice, your will, and your desired way. Show us that it's only over time and through growing our commitment to you that we will recognize your voice when we need it most. Lord, we lift this prayer to you.
We pray for compassionate ears, ears that are not heartlessly closed to the sick, the dying, the lonely, and the oppressed. Teach us a way of deep listening, where our hearts become openly receptive to some of the largest wounds of this world. Remind us of the privilege of remembering needs beyond our own. Lord, we lift this prayer to you.
Finally, we pray for excited ears, ears that are less overwhelmed by the traumas of these times and more delighted by the opportunity to be in solidarity with all peoples. Radiate your love into our lives. Help us be excited for every new breath of life, every blossom and bug that has a role in your creation, and every encounter we may have with someone who is unlike us. For all of these ears, we pray, sensitive ones, discerning ones, compassionate ones, and excited ones. By your grace, O Lord, make them a part of us. Amen.
shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life.
Together, let us pray the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
And now may the Lord bless you with deep listening skills, that the very ways in which you care about others and listen in on their lives will be your own spiritual hospitality to the world. Now let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.